We've come
to give God the glory.
To give God the glory.
Oh yes, we've come.
Oh yes, we've come
to give Him praise.
To give Him praise.
We've come to give Him the honor.
To give Him the honor.
Let's magnify Him.
Let's magnify Him.
In all of our ways.
In all of our ways.
Who are we?
We're interceding Christians enter. We hope that you felt welcome from the time that you entered into the house of the Lord.
Hallelujah to God Almighty. Be the glory once again. Apostle Dr. Schaefer sitting in my very lovely wife.
Pastor
Tina. Oh, we're just so excited about this new Bible study series that we launched about 4 weeks ago now. It's been a month.
It's not new
my
anymore.
My God.
It's not new anymore.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. It's not new. It's just such a blessing, though. Amen. It's coming from the book of Colossians.
Mm-hmm.
The book of Colossians. We've done chapter one.
Yes, and we're starting chapter two this week.
This
is our fourth lesson in this particular series entitled Set Your Mind on the Things Above, Be Ye Transformed.
Hallelujah.
And on tonight, we're going to talk about Paul's heart.
His
heart and the message that he wants to give to the Church of Colossae. And also the church of Laodicea was mentioned in this particular set of scriptures.
Exactly.
So we are getting ready to delve into. So I also want to remind you, if you have not listened to the previous studies, go back and listen to them. They are located on our YouTube channel, Interceding CC.
Yes.
And you will find a wealth of information in chapter one. There actually are three parts, and each part is very, very, very significant.
Yes.
Apostle, I believe that Apostle Paul, he wanted the saints in Colossae to understand, doctrine.
Yes.
Because this particular book is filled with doctrine. And
yes.
It's so important for us to understand, what we believe.
Amen.
Not just understand it, but understand it to the point where we can explain it
to someone.
And so Paul is being very rudimentary.
That's the word.
In this particular book. So we're gonna delve into chapter two on tonight.
Amen.
After
Let's
we pray.
Have a word of prayer. Amen.
Amen.
Have a word of prayer.
Amen.
And get your Bible and get ready to go with us to Colossians, the second book of Colossians.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
You pray for us on this evening.
Sure. Father, we thank you. We glorify you and we praise you, Lord God, for another day and another opportunity, Lord God, to be in your presence, Father. Father, we just pray that all that is done and all that is said on tonight, Lord God, be to your glory. And Lord God, that it be to edify the body, Father God. Father, we're just asking that you bless all that listen on tonight, Lord God. And Father, we're just praying right now that eyes are open and that revelations will flow like never before. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let's share our screen there.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Set your mind on the things above. Be ye transformed. It's dangerous to have your mind set on anything except the things above, isn't it?
Amen.
Hallelujah. This is a study from the book of Colossians, part four of our series. And the main theme of this is Paul's pastoral heart.
Amen.
And the burden. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Beep. We're going to first have ourselves a look at our objective for tonight, which is we're going to have a brief recap. And then we're going to discuss Paul's desires and concerns for the Church of Colossae. Beware.
Yeah, one of the things that Paul is going to talk about in this particular set of scriptures is enticing words.
Enticing words.
And we need to be aware.
Hallelujah.
Of enticing words.
Yes.
This is something that happened way back during Paul's time, and it's something that is really still relevant today.
Amen.
Amen.
The thing about enticing words is that enticing words are like a gold hook that's beautiful to the eye. It has a fine cut of meat on it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's cast into the water.
Mm-hmm.
The fish, all he sees is that beautiful hook flashing,
mm-hmm.
which gets his attention. and the fine cut of meat on it.
Wow.
But not realizing the danger therein.
Yeah.
Amen. 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 Recap highlights. Now, the book of Colossians was an epistle written by the Apostle Paul while he was in prison in Rome about AD 61.
Amen. And we already know where Colossae was located. And we know that it's located in present day Turkey today. And it's considered one of the churches that is located in Asia Minor.
Uh-huh.
Amen. We know that Paul never visited Colossae.
Never visited Colossae.
And some of the other churches he never visited, like Laodicea.
But we know that Colossae was a church. What we do know is that Colossae was a church that was spread by the gospel being spread abroad.
Amen.
It wasn't founded by any of the apostles set forth, you know.
Right.
But it was founded by the gospel being spread abroad.
Right, right. And we learned that, you know, in chapter one, we learned that Paul never ceases to pray for the church of Colossae. And he prayed that they would have knowledge and wisdom and understanding.
My God.
Just like we pray for our church, you know, during our corporate prayer and our daily prayer, we always lift up the church, you know, that we will stand in knowledge, wisdom, and understanding.
Yes, Lord.
And we pray that not just for the church, but for our children.
Yes, we do.
You know, and just in anything that we actually do. But Paul, he ceases to pray that they would have wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, and that they will be strengthened, you know,
right,
and grow.
Right. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Paul. The other thing is that Paul discusses the personage of Christ Jesus. Mm-hmm. Oh, my God.
Yes.
Oh, my God. We know he went to death because at that time, as you were saying earlier, there were false teachers who were ravenous wolves who were trying to incorporate paganistic doctrine and personal drive,
their own ideology, their own agenda
into what it was that the gospel was saying.
Exactly.
Amen.
Exactly.
So it encourages believers to be grounded in the word. It's so important to be grounded in the word.
So that they are not wavering.
Yes. With any wind of doctrine that comes about. Amen.
But he encouraged them to be grounded and settled and unmovable. Amen. And we know that Paul discussed his ministry.
Yes.
Not only did he discuss Jesus, you know, and the importance of knowing who he is and understanding the doctrine, but he wanted them to know that he was an apostle.
Yes.
That was appointed, you know, to the Gentile church to spread the gospel.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, so that
exactly.
so that everyone will be saved. Everyone
Amen.
Will have that opportunity to be saved.
Amen.
And so he I believe that he was really, you know, putting, hey, and here I am. I'm here, you know, as an authority in this mm-hmm. season, in this dispensation that we're in right now, you know, to benefit the church.
Yes,
you know,
yes.
And carrying out the mission that God had elected him for.
Exactly.
Amen.
Now, there are some who would think that Paul was being, what's the word I'm looking for? Facetious or self-promoting in this.
No.
But we have to understand this. Listen, we have to understand this.
Order.
We have to understand this. It's that the gospel was given unto, gospel ministry is given unto humankind to preach.
Amen.
Angels cannot preach the gospel.
Mm-mm.
Angels went to men on the instructions of God and told them what God wanted them to do, but they were not assign the role to preach the gospel.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because it takes the testimony of humankind to convince other humankind of what the gospel is. Amen.
Right.
Amen. So in Paul's teaching this, Paul was not beating his own drum.
He was not.
He was just telling them, this is what authority that God has given.
Given
this
me.
Is part of the fivefold mission that God has given me.
And not only that, but, you know, Paul was well known.
Yes.
He was well known as Saul.
Exactly.
And he was well known as Paul, too.
Yes,
You know, the church of Colossae was very familiar with who Paul was.
You know,
but
Paul
just
said
for clarity's sake.
Yes.
You know, Paul wanted to set the example.
Exactly.
And state what his particular agenda was.
Yes.
In this epistle.
And Paul sat in a very unique position, whereas he could reach Gentiles and Jews because of his understanding of the Old Testament, the Torah, mm-hmm. his understanding of the Torah, and his indoctrination by mule kick of yes. the New Testament, of the gospel. So he was mm-hmm. in a unique position to not only bring the gospel to the Gentiles, but mm-hmm. really to the Jews.
Right, right.
He could bring it to them as well. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. So that's our brief recap on tonight. We're going to go ahead and get into chapter 2, verse number 1. Apostle Schaefer is going to go ahead and read that for us on tonight.
Amen.
And then we're just going to talk about these scriptures as the Spirit of God gives us understanding.
Hallelujah. Colossians chapter 2, verse 1 says this, "But I would that ye know what great conflict I have for you mm-hmm. and for them at Laodicea mm-hmm. and for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh."
Amen. So, you know, we've been talking all throughout chapter one because, you know, we understand the background, you know, of this particular book. And we knew that Paul had not visited this church, but yes. here in this chapter, Paul actually states that he's never
exactly.
you know, shown his face. They have never seen his face,
yes.
you know, in Colossae.
Mm-hmm.
But going back to that first phrase, it says, "For I would that ye know what great conflict." Here, Paul has concerns.
His concerns for the people.
Right.
It's the humanistic conflict, right. whereas if you love someone,
mm-hmm.
it's conflicting in you
right.
to not to be able to see
right.
them because that's your desire.
Mm-hmm. Because there's a concern for him
yes.
burning in his spirit,
mm-hmm.
you know, for the saints there.
Yes,
you know,
exactly.
So he had great concern for him. It wasn't that he had a fight or had an issue himself,
mm-hmm.
but he had great concern for the churches of Colossae.
Right.
And then he mentioned here in the next phrase for them at Laodicea.
Right.
Okay. So that is another church that he was really
right.
concerned about. He
yes,
was so concerned
yes.
that he wrote an epistle.
Exactly.
And not in him writing. See, many people had seen Paul's face and he's preached a many of sermons and different things like that. But just to know he had great concern
yes.
for these two churches that he mentioned.
Yes.
And these words that he has written in the epistle is now available to us.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, Paul understood
how important, you know, this message is for.
He understood the anointing.
Mm-hmm.
Paul understood the anointing. He knew that in his writing, which I don't think he really knew how impactful his writing was going to be,
wow.
but he knew that writing,
right?
He knew in his writing, it would have anointing on it.
Right.
It would have some impact.
Uh-huh.
But Paul also knew that as impactful as his writings was to the
mm-hmm.
people,
mm-hmm.
him presenting the same to them face to face would have even a greater impact. So
Amen.
That was that great conflict, you know. I'm gonna give you this letter, right?
Uh-huh.
But conflicting, I really would rather see you.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah.
Right.
Now,
because when you're able to see someone, you're able to see their expressions.
Yes.
You're able to look at them and see if they really are getting understanding.
Yes.
You know, and not just receiving words,
mm-hmm.
you know, because sometimes when you receive words, you can be unattached.
Right.
But when you're in person, there's a different type of communication that's going on.
Hallelujah.
Although in this epistle, it's written, we can go and we can study
mm-hmm.
it and study it and study it, but there's nothing like that face-to-face interaction.
That's something about
when you're
that.
Able to see their emotion.
Hallelujah.
You're able to see if their hands are folded or if they have an expression on their face, you know.
Yes.
And Paul, I mean, it really soothes our soul when we're able to see our loved ones when
Hallelujah.
We're talking,
Amen.
You know, to them. To see if they're receptive, if they're open, if they understand, are they joyous about it? I mean, you know, so this is the great conflict, you know,
mm-hmm.
that Paul had.
Well, it's like if you go to a sporting event, you can also watch the same sporting event on TV,
mm-hmm.
but you just don't get the same impact
mm-hmm.
from watching on TV as you do when you're there.
Amen.
There's some about that personal thing. Amen. But you know, there's some here that Paul mentioned that actually says quite a bit about the evangelistic journeys and things he had done. Mm-hmm. Now we see here, for I would that ye know what great conflict I have for you. He's talking to Colossae, mm-hmm. but he said, and for them at Laodicea,
right?
Talking to the church at Laodicea.
And
for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh. So he's indicating there's other churches.
Right.
Oh my God. Right. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen. That's powerful. Amen.
That is Hallelujah. Very powerful.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, that is powerful. Let's go to verse number two. Verse number two reads, go ahead, Apostle.
That their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love, and unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding, to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ.
Amen.
So
there's quite a bit in this particular scripture.
He wanted them to be comforted.
Right. He wanted them to be comforted, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. and if we want somebody to be comforted, then there's a thought or some ideal in our minds that there may be some
turmoil, internal turmoil. Right. You know, actually, it's like Paul's referring back to his understanding. You know, he had conflict himself.
Mm-hmm.
So he had internal turmoil himself. But he said, I know that I have internal turmoil.
Mm-hmm.
So I know that them being human as well, they have internal turmoil as well. Mm-hmm. So I'm praying and I'm writing to them that they might be comforted in their heart.
Right. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Hallelujah.
Confident, you know, concerning their faith.
Yes.
Confident concerning their salvation.
Oh God.
And the doctrine, you know, mm-hmm. because I'm sure that they were aware that there were people that were teaching things that were not true.
Oh, yes, of course.
And so it disturbs you, you know, when that is going on. So Paul, you know, wanted them to be comforted.
That your hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
That's a powerful statement.
Oh, my God, it really is. Because, comforted, you know, if you look at confident.
Knit together in love. Together, knit together is unity.
Yes, unity. It is. It is unity. Unified in love.
Right, in love.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
In love.
It's hard to be knit together
mm-hmm.
unless you're comfortable with the people that you're around.
Confident.
Be comfortable with the people around.
Being knit together in love. And then he didn't say in peace. He didn't say in those things.
Right.
It's great to be knit together in peace.
Yes, it
but
is.
But what is more powerful than love?
That's right. Nothing else.
We go back to Corinthians when we talk about love.
Love. Amen. Amen.
You know,
1 Corinthians 13. Amen. Talks about love.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
So, and then what better way to be knitted together? Because scripture after scripture tells us, you know, that we are known by our love for one another.
Yes. Yes.
You know
yes.
what I mean?
Yes,
and then
yes, yes.
Knit together in love, understanding that, you know, each of us are different,
mm-hmm.
Apostle.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
each of us are different.
Yes, we are.
And each of us have struggles
mm-hmm.
that
mm-hmm.
You may have a struggle that I don't go through.
Right.
Or I may have a struggle that you may not go through. And so there may not be understanding,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
why are you going through this? And it may look easy to you, but it's difficult to that person. But experiencing that love,
yes.
you know what I mean?
Yes.
Loving
yes.
somebody through a situation,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
loving someone through, even when you're offended, if you knit together in love
yes.
and forgiveness, you know
my
what
God.
I mean? When you love, you're willing to forgive. I mean, love covers a multitude of faults.
Exactly.
So knit together in love, knowing that there's nobody or nothing just perfect.
Amen. You know, the word knit caught my attention.
Knit.
You know, because I remember, you know, back in the 70s,
mm-hmm.
you know, knitting was the big thing.
70s, exactly.
80s, knitting was the big thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I remember my mom had a yarn drawer.
Right.
Right. And in the yarn drawer, she had many colors.
Right.
Many colors.
Uh-huh.
Many diversified colors.
Mm-hmm.
So being knit together in love means that you should be able to love someone that's a little different than you
that's
are.
That's right.
You know, that just speaks of the diversity of the love of God. God loved variety.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Uh-huh. And Amen. Then when you're knit together, I mean, you use different types of yarns
yes.
in order to develop a blanket that may have different patterns and colors
exactly.
and stuff.
But
exactly. when you're knit together, you're mm-hmm. you're in this part of the blanket and you function this way.
Yes.
Or you look
yes.
this way.
Yes.
And each area or section of the blanket is important.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
In order for it to be whole, you know, so knitting together, just coming together. You know, and being one in unity and love.
Yes, my God. You know, when you said that, it reminded me of not only were different types of yarn mm-hmm. in there, mm-hmm. there were also different types of needles.
Amen.
And then there were also different types of knitting patterns that right. they used.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in the center of the blanket, they would have a different needle than they would have at the edge.
Mm-hmm.
They would use a different pattern because the pattern on the edge was different. It was stronger than the pattern in the center, you know. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it just talks about the diversity.
Yeah.
The diversity. God loves right. diversity. Uh-huh. Amen.
And it says, and unto all the riches of the full assurance of understanding. So he wanted us not just to be comforted and united in love, but he wanted us to be filled with understanding.
Yes.
And now this understanding is not the understanding that we get from just our natural understanding, but full assurance of understanding.
Wow.
Said, and unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding. That's a godly
Hallelujah.
Understanding. That's,
Hallelujah.
That's a understanding that is at a level that's higher than natural understanding.
Amen. Amen. And I love the words you didn't highlight that.
What was that?
Riches.
Riches.
Riches. Oh my
the
God. That just speaks.
Of understanding.
Yeah, that speaks volumes about what Paul is saying here.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. You know, God who's omnipotent, omnipresent, omnipotent,
mm-hmm.
omnipotent, God who knows all.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah. He's pushing them to have confidence.
Right.
That God is able.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Right.
Hallelujah.
To have full understanding. And then it says the acknowledgement of the mystery
God.
Of God. Now we understand, you know, from our previous studies that mystery of God, you know, was the church
mm-hmm.
In the New Testament.
Right.
That
right.
was the mystery that wasn't known, you know,
yes,
in the Old Testament.
Yes.
Yes. So it says the acknowledgement of the mystery of God.
The church.
And of the Father and of Christ.
Now, acknowledgement of the mystery of God, the church. You know, it tells in the Bible, God's ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts, right?
Mm-hmm.
If it was our chore to save the world,
mm-hmm.
we wouldn't have saved it by an innocent.
Mm-mm.
Hallelujah. That's crazy talk to some folks. You know, it's, mm-hmm. Oh, no, I ain't giving my son over for this. You know what I'm saying? It's just, so God, what God did just shocked the world and shook the foundations of hell.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It's a mystery.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory
church.
Unto God. And of the Father and of Christ.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. So we're going to move on to verse number 3. And it reads, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge.
My God.
In whom?
Christ.
Amen.
Christ.
In Christ.
Yes. Yes. It refers back to 2.
Hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge.
My God.
The treasures
this is
of
the
wisdom and knowledge.
Spiritual wisdom and spiritual knowledge.
Right, right.
Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen. Because, you know, in the point, the bullet there, it says, in Christ, there is
no lack.
Now, we know in our natural treasures and our natural wisdom and understanding and knowledge, you know, there's lack.
There's a limit.
And there's a limit.
No matter
there's
how
lack.
Well off a multi-billionaire
lack.
Is, he doesn't have all the money in the world.
Right.
So there's a lack there.
Right. But in Christ,
there's
no lack because
the
he is the fullness. Amen.
The
so,
fullness.
And the comments said, all one is and all one needs to know
is in him.
It's in Christ. That's why we live and we breathe Christ.
You know,
Christ is everything. Our lives are Christ-centered.
Yes, they are.
Because
they are.
If it's any other way, there is lack. There's not fullness. There's no fullness.
Amen.
Because there's only fullness in him. There's no lack in him.
Glory.
Amen. Verse number 4 reads, and it says,
"And this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words."
Now, Paul is saying something right here. This is one of his warnings.
Mm.
He said, "And this I say, lest any man should beguile you." So this is a warning.
Yes.
It says, "Lest any man should beguile."
Go back to verse 3 real quick. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
"In whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge."
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about Christ. Mm-hmm. Now go back to 4. Hallelujah. And Paul was talking about, I talked about Christ and how everything is in him.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to have soothsayers and all types of naysayers, all types of heresy that's going to come against you.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't want you to be beguiled or fooled.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Because everything that we have and need
is in Christ.
It's in Christ.
He
said, "Lest any man beguile you." And what does it mean to beguile you?
Hoodwink you.
To fool you. Mm-hmm. To victimize you.
With
what?
Enticing words. My God. This is talking about what James talked about, how sweet the tongue is.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah.
Enticing words. Words are words that one may desire to hear.
Mm-hmm.
I got here in our notes that it's what we call sweet talk.
Yeah. Ear tickling.
Charming.
And now what you said there is real important to know that. Desire one that they desire to hear.
Mm-hmm.
The more you desire to hear
mm-hmm.
something that's contrary to Christ, the quicker you are to be able to accept those enticing words.
To be beguiled.
It's acceptable to be beguiled. Oh, okay, put that AD in there.
Amen.
So
we know, you know, this is a warning, you know. Warning number one, don't be fooled by sweet talk, by enticing, enchanting words Hallelujah. That make you feel good.
Yes,
you know,
yes,
everything
yes.
that feel good is not necessarily good.
Okay, try the spirit by the spirit.
Yeah, so how do we not be beguiled? You know
the word.
You got to know the word. You have to know the word. Because in verse 3 and the previous verses, we learned that Jesus, you know, everything that we need is in him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because in him is the fullest. I mean, he in him is no lack.
Yes.
In him is all knowledge. Hallelujah. Is in him. So when we know our Bibles, we have to get in our Bibles. We have to study the word. So
Amen.
That we won't be beguiled.
Wow.
So we won't be enticed by words that causes us to waver.
Exactly.
We have to know, you know, what you know.
What you know.
Amen.
What you know.
So we don't, I mean, in today's world, we're enticed by wealth, you know.
Power.
And influence.
You know, this is why we have wealthy politicians, wealthy people who run for political office.
That's right.
Because they got wealth now.
That's right.
They want power.
Mm-hmm.
They want power. Right. They want influence.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
They want to be acknowledged as knowledgeable.
Exactly.
Right.
And not just in the secular world, but you can have that going on
in the church. Oh, my God. What you said.
And what I mean, and think about it. If you're going to be beguiled with enticing words, those words are not coming from the outside.
They're within the church.
They're within what Paul was talking inside. About.
Someone who's able to bring it to you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, if you allow those beguiling words, you know, allow people close enough to you to bring those beguiling words, you know?
Right.
My God.
But you can be careful who you admire. You can have a man of God, you know, in the pulpit, you know, preaching, you know, and that person can be delivering enticing words.
Yes, yes.
And unless you know your Bible, unless you know your words, you won't recognize. You'll be in the amen corner agreeing with whatever is going on.
Exactly.
You know, so exactly. Paul wants us to be aware of enticing words that will fool us.
My God.
That will get us going down the wrong track.
Exactly. You know, when you allow
things that we should not be involved in.
When you allow wealth, power, influence, secular knowledge to influence or guide your decisions, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We have people who allow those things and then they try to find biblical basis to justify that.
Exactly. And then if you're not deep enough in your word, you'll be fooled.
Yes, you will. You'll be fooled. And the enemy will bring you right to a scripture to justify that foolishness.
Exactly.
Hallelujah.
Yep. In verse 5, which is the last scripture we're going to cover on tonight. Oh my goodness,
really? Yes, it's the last one.
This is the last one for tonight. Okay. And so verse 5.
For though I be absent in the flesh, Paul talking about himself, I'm not there with you, yet am I with you in the spirit. Paul's talking about the power of prayer. God is not limited by time nor space. Join in beholding your order. He's happy. And the steadfastness of your faith in Christ.
Amen. Amen.
Wow.
Amen.
That's
so
good.
He's reiterating, you know, although he's absent, you know, in the flesh.
Yes.
He's there in the spirit.
He's there in the spirit.
We can always be there in the spirit for those that whom we love. And we may not be there in person to go through certain things that they're going through. So we know that we can always be there in spirit through prayer. Through prayer. Amen.
Amen.
But here, he said he's in with them in spirit. He's joying.
He's joying.
He's happy.
Mm-hmm.
And beholding your order.
You know, I remember when I was in the military, our baby girl really didn't start walking until I was gone.
Mm-hmm.
I was going away on duty.
Mm-hmm.
And it was such a joy for me to hear that she was walking. It came telephonically, but it was such a joy.
Mm-hmm.
It was such a joy. So in other words, I'm joining and I'm beholding the order of things, how things go, right?
Right, exactly, exactly. Mm-hmm. So he's joying and beholding your order.
Yes. Meaning that they're disciplined. Disciplined.
Right.
Amen.
Meaning that they're standing their ground. Paul wanted them to maintain order.
Amen.
And the steadfastness of your faith.
Yes.
Meaning to be consistent. Steadfastness means to be consistent.
Yes.
Your faith. As they will not be carried away.
Right.
With enticing words. So, yeah. Go ahead.
Steadfastness. Mm-hmm. Let's break that word down.
Go ahead.
Now, the word stead means strong, firm, unchanging, unfallible, not easy to blow down. That's stead. Steadfastness. Mm-hmm. Fast itself in here means that it came, it stuck. It stayed. It's strong and quick. It's like the two-edged sword.
Right.
It's going to cut coming and going.
Mm-hmm.
So the steadfastness of their faith is speaking of how firm their faith was.
Mm-hmm.
It was speaking also of how they received readily the word of God. That's the speed of it, right?
Amen.
And they carried forward. Hallelujah.
Mm-hmm.
And they wouldn't let go until they, you know, they weren't going to let go of the truth. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. To God Almighty be the glory. Amen. That was short, but that was awful sweet.
Yes, it was.
That was awful sweet. Awesome. Amen. Yes, amen. Yes. You know, beloved, I'm thanking God for you. I'm praying that the Lord blesses you through these Bible study series that we are doing. Amen. We are going on in the faith of God on how he wants us to build lives.
Amen.
And build a faith walk among his people. Amen. Amen. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. So I'm just excited. I mean, just that one point that Paul reiterated in this set of scriptures, you know, it makes us mindful, you know, of what we're listening to.
Hallelujah.
You know, because we are to take the word that we're receiving. We are to study the word.
Yes.
And when we take it, we study it, we understand it, and we're able to be strengthened.
Yes.
And we're able to grow. We're able to be strengthened, and we're able to grow. Because there are two very important things that we must do, you know, as the church. One is to share salvation, and two is to strengthen and grow, you know, the church.
Yes, Lord.
Amen. That's
our
mission.
It's in a nutshell,
to spread the gospel.
Spread the gospel.
But when we spread the gospel, Jesus wants us to grow. We can't stay, you know, at that level of just salvation level only. Because at that level, we're still not able to share what we know.
Amen.
We have to delve into. And next week, we're going to be talking about delving into being baptized. I'm not going to get into it.
Amen. But, you know, I'm just thinking about how what you're saying is that, well, let me put it in a story. You know, I like to put it in forms of story. The prophet Moses, the prophet Moses, was gone away from the children of Israel for 40 days. Mm-hmm. And when he came down from the mountaintop, his face shone.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in a companion story, Jesus came down from the mountaintop and his face shined as well, right? You can't be in the presence of God.
Right, and not shine.
And not be shining,
mm-hmm.
not be impacted.
Right.
That's why it's so important for us to work on and toward growing in our relationship with the Lord.
And that shining is not something that's just to benefit ourselves.
Oh, Jesus.
But it's something that allows people to see his glory.
Hallelujah.
You know, in you.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
If I turn on a flashlight with a group of people, would I turn it on just for me? I'm turning on
so that we can see.
We can
exactly.
see. Amen.
Exactly.
Amen. To God Amen. Almighty be glory.
Tune in next week as we continue in our study through the book of Colossians chapter 2. We're going to go into another warning or two that Paul has for the church. So beware of enticing words. Do not be beguiled by them.
Amen. Beloved, if the Lord so touched your heart and you want to be a blessing to Interceding Christian Center, you can be a blessing by going to the Apple or the Android store and downloading the Giblify or the Cash app. If you choose to bless us using the Giblify app, look for Interceding Christian Center in West Memphis, Arkansas. See the beautiful picture of my lovely wife, First Lady Tina Schaefer, amen, and be a blessing to us in that way. Or alternatively, if you choose to bless us using the Cash app, what's our identification?
It's $INTERCEDINGCC.
Amen. $INTERCEDINGCC. Amen. Let us pray.
Amen.
Father, we thank you. We glorify you. We praise you for this time of sharing your word, oh God.
Thank you, Lord God.
Allow your word to go into the deep recesses of the hearts of the people, oh God. Let it be written upon the tables of their heart.
Yes,
Father God, bless, oh God, that they would not only just enjoy the word, but Father, they grow from the word.
Yes, Father.
Now we thank you in advance for all that you're going to do. It's in the matchless name of Jesus the Christ we do pray. Thank God.
Thank God.
Amen.
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 God bless you, love. Once again, Apostle Dr. Schaeferson and my very lovely wife, Pastor Tina. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We love you with the love of Christ.
We love you. God bless you.
Bless. I pray that you enjoyed the word today and that it touches you within a deep place in your heart and it would spark a change that should come about in your life.
If the Lord so touched your heart and you have a desire to give, you can give to this ministry as we continue to make impacts in this city at our Giblify app. Simply download the Giblify app at one of the app or the Google store and look for Interceding Christian Center. Here at Interceding, we aspire to bring people to spiritual knowledge and thus victory. God bless you.